Hello everyone. Welcome back to another episode of r/malicious compliance. In today's episode, you want to talk to my boss. Okay, but your internet isn't gonna fix itself. Next week, I'm going to fire you. Why aren't you ready to learn? Before we get started, be sure to subscribe so that you will never miss a video. Let's get started. So at the time I was working as tech support and customer services for a local ISP internet service provider. What follows is an hour-long interaction with an entitled scumbag who, as a result of his refusal to do even the most basic troubleshooting, ends up without internet for over 2 weeks and no compensation for it. I spent most of my time simply taking calls from customers, and since it's a relatively small company, we're a group. Usually between 5 to 15 working customer services and tech support at any given time, that handles any and all incoming calls for customers, do what we can to solve their problems as soon as they contact us, and when it's not possible, send a trouble ticket to the correct team. At this point, I've been doing this job for about a year when entitled scumbag ES from now on calls and telling me that his internet isn't working at all. After some basic remote troubleshooting, 5 minutes into the call I have identified what I believe is the problem. There's a connection to his home, but no devices are trying to connect. I assume that as in 9/10 cases with these symptoms, the problems related to customer EQ, equipment, broken Ethernet cables, etc. So to help him, I need to make sure the problem isn't related to his own EQ, since our policy was that in case the problem is within your own EQ and skipping our requested troubleshooting for a fault report will result in you getting billed for tech about 150 to 450 euro depending on how much work they've done before arriving at customer's place. Note, it is very rare that anyone actually gets billed for the tech. I simply ask ES to reboot his CPE customer premise equipment and connect his computer directly to it with a different Ethernet cable. This will most likely rule out problems with the router, cables, and faulty connections. Time for ES to show me that he's better than me. He goes ahead and informs me that he spent hundreds of euros for a company to install his home network. There cannot be any faults on that end. Me and my company must be at fault here. His stand on this is that I am to fix it there and then without him lifting a finger. I inform him that I can send a trouble ticket, but due to lacking information it will most likely sent back with a note need troubleshooting, and that he has to approve that he pays for the tech we send out to troubleshoot in case the fault is, as I suspect, in his own EQ. Instead of being reasonable and listening to why I need the information and why it's important to try it, he simply asks to talk to one of my colleagues, and this discussion comes and goes multiple times during my attempts to fix his internet. The longer we talk, the more toxic and personal the insults towards me. I try to keep a good face through it all, but at this point you can probably start hearing me get a bit frustrated that he calls me for help and refuses to let me help him. So I tell him, since you refuse to do basic troubleshooting or approving the fees, I'm going to end the call here. You're welcome to call us back at any time when you feel like troubleshooting your connection. This seems to make him realize that he's going to have to call us back again and sit in queue for another 30 minutes, so he finally gives in a bit and lets me start troubleshooting. However, we don't get far. It takes us about 15 minutes just to identify his own EQ, and identifying all the cables is an impossible task since it's just a snake's nest of cables in the closet that holds his CPE. At this point, I make a firm point about his own EQ being outside our support. I'd help most people with some basic troubleshooting of their own EQ. However, not if you're being rude. Then I'll stick to the company rule to not troubleshoot personal EQ, so he has to connect his computer to the CPE with a different cable after a quick reboot so we can check if we're actually delivering an internet connection to him. He manages to reboot the CPE, so I feel that half the battle is over. All we have to do now to confirm that his own EQ is the problem, connect the computer. At this point, ES snaps. He refuses any further troubleshooting, mutters something about why do I pay you if I have to do everything myself. I want to talk to your boss. So I inform him it will me about 10 workdays to get a callback from my boss, and he will not do any troubleshooting. I'd advise you to talk to my colleagues when you feel up to doing the basic troubleshooting, or you'll end up having to start that process up after talking to my boss. ES accepts. I create a ticket to my boss and notes down a comment in ES customer profile. Connection seems fine to CPE. Cust refuses basic troubleshooting. Try connecting PC to CPE directly if Cust calls back. Over the next 14 days, I can see in his customer profile that he's called about 10 times and talked to almost as many people. Everyone simply marks down refuses to troubleshoot, asking when boss will call, etc. Time for boss to call. So my boss starts out with talking to me about what happened and I give him my side of the story. Decides that he will listen to the phone call before calling him back. After listening to the call, my boss informs him that you will have to call tech support to do some basic troubleshooting, and we will not compensate you for any of this in case the problem is in your own EQ, since that's not something that we're supporting. You'd have to talk to the company that installed it for you then. My boss even told me I had done a good job staying calm and constructive through his shitstorm. So he calls the support once again, does what I asked him the first time, and in about 15 minutes of troubleshooting with a colleague of mine, his problems are resolved. His own EQ wasn't connected properly. My colleagues flat out refuses any kind of further support once we identified that his internet is working fine with his computer. No one wants to help him more than they have to now. I obviously forgot to note down how I asked him to remove a couple of cables from his home network so we'd have to cables to test. As far as I know, he probably had to hire someone or ask a friend to get his own network back up. Bill for being an entitled scumbag who thinks they know everything and refuses to accept help. About 18 days with no internet, and no compensation for downtime since there wasn't any problems on our end and probably no working home network. I know this isn't the greatest story Malicious Compliance has ever seen, but I hope it was worth your time to read. I'm not a very experienced Reddit poster, so my apologies if it's in the wrong thread. I don't claim to be a great writer, so feel free to rewrite my story and post it elsewhere if you wish, and ask if there's anything you want to know about it. Will not reveal company, names of people, etc. of course. Next week, I'm going to fire you. Worked for a shitty airline company. Let's just make up a name. United Blairlines. At this company, they started a smaller company that could hire and train people to run the planes, but pay them way less at certain airports. Where my colleagues at other airports were making over $20 an hour, I was getting paid $10.25 for the same and sometimes more work. It honestly would scare you to know how little the people who are the ones that make sure your plane takes off safely are paid. All of us had to do three jobs to be able to pay rent. And we were all in the job for the benefits, free flights to anywhere in the country on standby. Anyway, I had a boss, we'll call him Jim. I could tell many stories on how terrible of a boss he was. But this one has actual Malicious Compliance. I had to go to the hospital from the airport because of intense pain in my stomach. It turns out that because of stress caused by that job, my intestines decided to stop functioning. Anyway, I spend the day in the hospital and then they gave me a note saying that I didn't have to work the next 2 days. I told Jim's boss that, since I hated talking to Jim. When I went back into work 3 days later, we had 5 people total to load all luggage, load the water, and push out 5 planes in a little over an hour. Already an incredible amount of work for so few people. We had our morning work meeting to discuss how ducked we were. Then Jim asked me into his office. Your attendance is unacceptable, he said. Dumbfounded, I asked what he meant. You've been late a couple of times, and now missing the past 3 days. I said, Jim, I have the note from the hospital. According to work policy, that shouldn't affect my attendance. I don't care what work policy says. I'm going to fire you. Again, I cited work policy since we were protected by a union. I said, Jim, you have to give me an attendance warning before you're allowed to fire me for attendance. This is the first time I'm hearing about attendance, so you can't fire me right now. Jim said, it doesn't matter, I'm going to give you a warning right now, and when I get back from vacation next week, you're going to be fired. Now go back to work, my decision is final. So, I told my co-workers what happened. Then I decided, alright, well, if next week he's firing me, I'll just leave now. Even though their day was about to be ducked, since now 4 people were working 5 planes. They all said, duck this place, get out of here. So I left and went to get breakfast. This all happened at 4 a.m. As I'm enjoying my meal, Jim calls me. I happily ignore. He calls 3 more times and then texts me, asking where I was at. I told him, you fired me, why would I keep working for you? No response. I try to soak in the sight of Jim running between planes like a chicken with his head cut off. I don't imagine any plane took off on time that morning. I get a call from HR, and the union rep, and the general manager, who is Jim's boss. They all said Jim was wrong and asked me if I could come back to work it out. But quitting felt so good, and I felt such weight lifted off my shoulders thinking about not working there anymore. So I never went back. Some more info. Although this isn't so satisfying, it's more a testament of United Blairline's complete lack of ethics. Jim got in really big trouble when he had a guy who had a shoulder injury and had a note and told Jim several times he couldn't do super heavy labor. Jim sent him to the bag room by himself anyway. Imagine having to lift 300 to 700. 50 to 70 pound bags over your head per hour all while running between bag carts and the belt. Needless to say, the guy tore his shoulder and had to get surgery on it. They still didn't fire Jim. Instead, they promoted him to manage the workers who did ticketing and no manual labor. As far as I know, Jim still works for United. My co-worker still cannot move the way he used to 2 years later. Why aren't you ready to learn? So as soon as I finished high school, I got a job as a teaching assistant for special educational needs children in a different high school. It was a really fun, albeit difficult and demanding job. And this is one of many similar stories. For context, I was 20 at the time, 5 feet tall, and I naturally look a lot younger than I am. If I had a dollar for every time someone said I'll be happy when I'm 30, I'd have the money to buy higher heels. To make the age gap less of an issue, I exclusively worked with kids aged 11 to 14. Though half in a class were still taller than me, I would sit next to kids in class who needed help, or who were generally disruptive, or float around the room to try and help the teacher's class go smoothly. But I was definitely the youngest Tia there, with most of the others being 40 plus. I was in the UK at the time, and so my role in the room was usually not confusing since every student wears a school uniform, and I obviously do not. However, on this one day of twisted fate, I walked into a year 8 maths class on what is called Mufti Day, which is essentially a non-uniform day. I am trying to get the kids settled, who have known me for almost a year now, including several ADHD children, to Down syndrome children, and a large gaggle of rowdy boys, the kind that think anything is funny as long as it isn't polite, correct, or anything the teacher says. These boys were my favorites. It was the hardest class any T I had to handle, and I was waiting on both the teacher and a second T. Then the teacher does walk in, but he is a substitute teacher, IKI, doesn't normally teach here and is just filling in, which isn't unusual. First, he hands to kids some worksheets to hand out and gives me the third batch. Again, not abnormal since I hand out lots of things for the teachers. We eventually sit down, and I decide for the time being to sit in between two of the naughty boys, right at the front, to keep them under control, since the mere presence of a substitute teacher is enough to send their deviant brains into an overdrive of what can we get away with. Spoiler, usually they can get away with anything. Mr. S begins the lesson, talking about something or other when he stops right in front of my desk. He frowns at my empty table. Mr. S, do you not have a worksheet? Me, oh no sir, I don't need one. Me S, where is your pencil case? Why don't you need one? And why aren't you ready to learn? He said this very sternly and the entire class was quiet. Sub teachers are known for being nastily strict at the start of the lesson to let the kids know you can't mess around with them. When you totally can. Me, holding my lanyard up. I'm a teaching assistant. Boy next to me, sir, she's not a student. The poor man turns as white as a sheet and the boys and the rest of the class start howling with laughter. He apologizes about 6 times, and it takes a good few minutes to quiet everyone back down. Throughout the rest of the class, the kids kept bringing it up, and every time I passed Mr. S, he apologized again. Although the incident did make me think that should I ever want a day off, all I had to do was turn up in school uniform and blend right in. If you made it to the end of the video, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share, and we will see you in the next video.